Thanks, Grandpa.
I'm not gonna do this. Definitely, but I'm not gonna be a part of this. First time I'm eligible.
Yeah. One in the nursing home, interview, I had to talk about it, she was like.
This is the time for all the dog tickets, sending out a message, trying to deal with Christmas cheer. The season of happiness, joy, and love. Daddy will be born, he got down, so I'm blessed, so that we gonna do more again, and love him, and love him, esteem him, and love him for the things that he'll do, and the things he won't be, you don't show, I know, with the Lord, it's not for me, you can tell my testimony, like me, we need to see, I can tell you how he turned me on, and turned me all up around, he gave me the Holy Ghost, and put my feet on the ground.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Merry Christmas in advance.
Merry Christmas.
Amen. Very soon, next week. Is it Friday? Yes, Friday. So I want to take the opportunity to wish everybody Merry Christmas, just in case I forget to say one to you or text you. Amen. We thank God for another Sunday, another wonderful day that God has created for you and I. Amen. It's not every day that we get this opportunity. Amen. The Bible says that this is the day that the Lord has made for us to rejoice and be glad in it. I know that some of us, we've gone through so many things this year. We've been through pain and suffering. We've lost loved ones. Just this week, we lost our own brother Gerald. Amen. And it is so painful that sometimes we have to go through all these. But the life that we're leading is such that just as we came in, there's going to be a time for us to go back to our Maker. Amen. The Bible says it in Ecclesiastes, there's a time for everything. Amen. And so this morning, I want to lift up our spirits. Let us not be discouraged. Amen. The Bible says in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 8, it says that we should be praying everywhere. So you never know when and at what point something will happen. And so we got to be praying everywhere. That's what 1 Timothy 2 and 8 says. Pray everywhere and not doubting and not having wrath, anger, and doubt in your heart. And so as Christians, I want to encourage us this morning. The times that we live in, it's difficult. It is tough. And we all know it. But with prayer, I can guarantee you, God will see us through. Amen. God will see us through with prayer. No matter how difficult, how challenging the situation might be. If it's so difficult, you can't do anything. Just scream or shout, God, help me. No matter how difficult the situation might be, scream and shout and tell God, God, help me. And God will help you. Amen. I always say that God is just right beside you and I. If we don't call upon him, he will not answer. That is why Jeremiah 33 verse 3 says, call upon me and I will answer and show you great and mighty things that we do not know. And so this morning I'm here to encourage you. I want us to stand on our feet and pray and lift this morning's service into the hands of God and pray for those who've lost loved ones. Our own brother Gerald, let's pray for the wife and the family. It's not easy. Amen. My own wife also lost a senior brother. It is not easy. But through it all, God is sustaining all of us. Amen. You may know somebody who must have lost a loved one through this pandemic. But we pray that God himself will comfort all of us. And he will strengthen us as we are about to celebrate Christmas, the birth of Christ that has brought you and I the salvation that we need. Let us go before God in prayer. Eternal God, this morning we thank you. And we bless you for the opportunity that, Lord, you've given unto us to stand before your presence. Bible declares that in your presence there's a fullness of liberty and joy. And so this morning, regardless of whatever we're going through, regardless of the pain and the suffering that we are going through, regardless of, Father, the loved ones that we have lost, we come before your presence. We come to you as our Father, as our Abba Father. The Lord, you will have mercy upon us, O God, on this earth. On this side of glory, Lord, we ask that you will have mercy and reach out your hand and touch us. This morning we pray that we ask for forgiveness of our sins, O God. Sins of omission and commission, O God. We ask for, Father, you will cleanse us with the blood of Jesus. Father, from the head of this country to the least, O God, we ask for forgiveness in the name of Jesus. There's so many things that has gone on, oh God, throughout this year, for which, oh God, we're going through this pandemic. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus, we ask for forgiveness, and we ask that you will cleanse us with the precious blood of Jesus and make us pure and holy and blameless before thy sight. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that even as, oh God, we're losing loved ones, we pray. We lift as many as our lost loved ones, oh God, in your hands. Our own brother Gerard's wife, oh God, sister Gerard, Lord, we ask in Jesus' name. It is difficult in times like this that we were not prepared for it, but Lord, you know the reason why it happened like that. And so, Lord, we'll lift our dear sister into your hands. Wherever she might be right now, Lord, touch her, oh God. Send your angels, oh God, to comfort her 24/7 in the name of Jesus. Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus. We ask for your comfort in these times. We ask for your protection, oh God. We ask for strength from above in the name of Jesus. We ask, oh God, that anything, oh God, our dear sister is going through, and as many as have lost loved ones, oh God, through this pandemic, Lord, reach out your hand and touch them. In times, oh God, that, Father, they feel like crying, Lord, I pray that let them scream and shout and say that, God, help me, oh God. And as they say that, Lord, I pray that you will reach out and you will touch them. Touch them, oh God, one by one, name by name, oh God, in the name of Jesus. As many of us, oh God, that are sick in our physical bodies, our elders, oh God, who can't come here, we pray that, Lord, reach out your hand this morning and touch them. Touch them, oh God, and relieve them from the pain and the suffering that they are going through in the name of Jesus. We know that there is nothing too hard for you, oh God. And we know that, Lord, oh God, there is no distance, oh God, in prayer. And where we are standing right now, we ask, oh God, reach out and touch everyone. From the north, the south, east, and west, and every part of this world, oh God, our families, oh God, both far and near, we ask that you would touch them. Touch every member that is here, oh God, this morning. Those who couldn't make it, and those who are on their way, we're coming here, touch them. We lift our pastor into your hands, oh God. He's also been through a lot, oh God, but Lord, we thank you that he is still standing in the name of Jesus. Thank you that he's held on unto your promises, oh God, for which, oh God, has made him strong. And so, Lord, we thank you for his life and thank you for the life of the wife, oh God, the first lady, oh God. Continue to encourage them, continue to lift them up, oh God, and continue to use them in these end times. We know that the times that we are in are challenging, but with you, oh God, we know that everything shall work well for our good in the name of Jesus. We thank you and we bless you and we glorify your name. Thank you for whatever you are about to do this morning. We thank you, sweet Holy Spirit, for your presence here. Let us not leave here to be the same. And we ask that when it's all said and done, all glory and honor shall be given unto you. We give you praise, we give you glory. In Jesus' mighty name we've asked it all. And all shall say amen. Give a clap offering unto Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. At this hour, we call on Deacon Cotton to bring us a scripture and a prayer. Amen.
God bless you.
Psalms 34, and we're going to read three verses. We're going to read 4, 6, and 17. When you had it, say amen, please.
Amen.
Amen. Verse 4, I sought the Lord, and he heard me and delivered me from all my fears. 6, this poor man cried out, and the Lord heard him and saved him of all his troubles. 17, the righteous cry out, and the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their troubles. I've read verses 4, 6, and 17. May God bless the hearers and readers of his holy word. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. But before we go, I've been sick for about 30 days now. And last night was the first night I was able to sleep without any pain. And I just want to praise God right now for how he's made a way in my life. Oh, Heavenly Father, merciful God, we just humble ourselves now, God, and come before you with thanksgiving, realizing, God, it's you that we must look to. It's you that's able to do anything but fail. It's you that is the Most High God, the true God, the living God, the all-merciful and all-caring God. And we just glorify your holy and righteous name. We lift you up now, God, for we just truly thank you for how you've made a way in and through our lives. Father, consider the unfortunate, the sick, the shed in, those that have lost loved ones, God. I pray, God, that you touch like only you can. Comfort, God, like only you can. We know that you are a healer, for your word said that you are a healer. Father, I understand now what the meaning is all men should pray. God, I've prayed these last 30 days so much, God. And to know that you're hearing my prayer, God, is truly amazing. It's truly humbling, God. And I just thank you for that. God, bless these people in your house today. Would you please keep them, God, those that are sick in their bodies? Would you just put your loving arms around them, God? Would you hide them in your tabernacle, in your stronghold? Keep us, God. We need you, God, more than ever. Continue to lift up our pastor, God. Continue to touch him in a special way. Continue to heal his body, heal his mind. Give him a word, God, that will prick hearts on today, that they may come running asking, what must they do? Use us, God, to share your word, to share the love of Jesus Christ. We just thank you for how you made a way in our lives, God. Bless each and every one of us as we prepare ourselves to serve you today. Not just the music ministry, the VSL, the leaders of this church, God. We just thank you for them, God, how they make their way every Sunday, early Sunday, to prepare this place for worship. We just give you all the glory, God. We pray you be lifted up. Pray you be magnified and exalted, God. We just thank you so much for your tender mercy and your grace. We ask this now through your darling son, Christ Jesus. Amen.
Some say, walk with me, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Somebody celebrate the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
Good morning, saints. Come on, give the Lord some hand praise. Amen. We bless the Lord for our praise team and they rendering songs of praises to our God. Come on, give the Lord some praise for our praise team. Oh, we can do better than that. I know we can. Come on, everybody, put your hands together. Understand, brothers and sisters, I know we're not in full force in these days and time, but we thank God for those that have been committed, those that have been dedicated to give praises to our God through inspirational singing. Amen. Thank God for our minister of music, amen, and him rallying the troops, those who are willing to come and share. Amen. We bless the Lord for him as well. He's been here weekly, amen, and he's been due diligent in his efforts and lifted up by God through praise and worship. Come on. It's all right to praise the Lord. Amen. Y'all get loose now. Come on. Come on. See, if it's not any looseness in the pews out there, it ain't going to be tightness up here. And I don't want to be tight today. I feel pretty good today. I feel better than I've felt in a long time. So let go and let God have his way today. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, oh dear God, how we give glory and honor and praise to your name for being the great God that you are. You have kept us from seen and unseen danger. And we thank you, dear God, for these thy people who have come together and to lift up your holy and righteous name, because we are mindful of the fact you alone are worthy and you are worthy of our praise. We share sentiments with the psalmist when he said, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills from which cometh my help. For my help comes from the Lord which made heaven and earth. So Heavenly Father, we keep our eyes focused and fixed on you, because we know I have not seen, ear have not heard, neither have it entered into the hearts of men what you have in store for us. So we bless you for this band of believers that have gathered together on this day, dear God, to praise your holy and righteous name. Now, dear God, as we prepare our minds for this thy word, I pray, dear God, as always, that you allow me to sit down and you stand up. Let me decrease that you might increase. And above all, dear God, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts might be pleasing and acceptable in thy sight. For you, O God, are our strength and you are our redeemer. All things we ask by faith in that name that's above every name is in the precious, awesome, majestic, magnificent, mighty name of Jesus we pray and ask all things. Amen. Now come on, bless the Lord. Amen. Our praises be unto God that we serve. Amen. If you be so kind, turn to me with me to 1 Corinthians, the 3rd chapter. Amen. And I want us to be very, very attentive to the words of our text on this morning. Chapter 3. And we want to read for your listening ears. Verse 1. Amen. Down through 15. I know that's extensive reading, but I've always heard if that's a long text, then there's very less preaching that will take place in the pulpit. So y'all pray for me this morning. And the word of God reads as thus, and I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ. I have fed you with milk and not with meat, for hitherto ye were not able to bear it, neither yet now are ye able, for we are yet carnal. For whereas there is among you envying and strife and division, are you not carnal and walk as men? For while one said, I am of Paul, and another, I am Apollos, are ye not carnal? Who then is Paul and who is Apollos, but ministers by whom ye believe, even as the Lord gave to every man? I have planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. So then neither is he that planted anything, neither is he that watered, but God that giveth the increase. Now he that planted and he that watered are one, and every man shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. For we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandmen, husbandry. Ye are God's building. According to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed how he buildeth thereon. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if any man build upon this foundation gold, silver, precious stone, wood, hay, stubble, every man's work shall be made manifest, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. If any man's work abide which he had built thereon, he shall receive a reward. If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire. Amen. Those are the words of our text. The grass withered, the flowers faded thereof, and may the words of our God last forever. From those words, we would like to lift up this subject, building on the proper foundation. Amen. You may have your seats. Amen. Prayerfully, you're going to be praying with me this morning, because I feel pretty good today. I ain't felt this way in a long time, but I feel pretty good today. Amen. In our text this morning, the Apostle Paul's reason for addressing this particular letter to the church at Corinth and the believers there is that he wanted to encourage them about spiritual development and also to recognize their potential that was available to them in Christ. And that's exactly what my focus is on this morning, brothers and sisters, and that is for the self-same purpose. Paul is addressing the saints at Corinth. Therefore, for all the saints, the believers, and the visitors, and also my OWBC family, and for those who may be listening to us over the internet, It is my attempt to encourage the saints to stay focused on the Lord. Tell your neighbor, stay focused on the Lord. Amen. In spite of what you may have heard, and I know we've hearing some stuff right now. They talk about shutting down churches today. We ain't shutting down. I'm telling you that right now. Amen. There's a such thing as church and state, and we are separate from the state. We're going to lift up our God as long as he allowed us to. We're doing all of the things that they've asked us to do. Amen. Social distancing. Amen. We are being safe. We are concerned not only about ourselves, but we're concerned about other folk as well. So I'm telling y'all right now, don't be calling me, asking me, Pastor, we going to have church? We having church. Therefore, let me just say, for all the saints, the believers, and the visitors, and also my OWBC family, and to those of you who may be listening, amen, it's my attempt to encourage the saints to stay focused on the Lord. In spite of what you maybe have heard and what this world is dealing with, we are trusting the Lord regardless of what our local officials are saying regarding church during this pandemic. We are going to continue to take extra precautionary measures to ensure the safety of ourselves and the safety of others, but we will continue to look to the hills for which cometh our help. For our help comes from the Lord who made the heavens and earth. It doesn't come from, amen, Washington, and it don't come from the Governor Abbott, and I said his name. Our help comes from the Lord that made heaven and earth. And I believe God, our God, is well capable of being able to keep us from seen and unseen danger, even through this pandemic. Come on, y'all, say amen. I mean, I'm on fire today. Y'all might well get with me. However, according to what Paul is addressing in our text this morning, Paul teaches us that we can either use non-combustible materials such as gold, silver, and precious stone for the construction of our lives, or we can use wood, hay, or straw. And yes, brothers and sisters, it is critical in the choice you choose. However, brothers and sisters, there is a big difference in the choice you choose based on what is outlined in our text. Understand, the text lays out in reference to non-combustible material over against combustible material. So take note of the fact Paul talks about non-combustible material such as gold, silver, precious stone. Understand, it would only get a good cleaning when it undergoes fire. However, Paul addresses combustible materials such as wood, hay, and straw, depending on what version you're reading from, or stubble you are using. Amen. It will be consumed by fire. Therefore, we must be careful in the material we use to build our lives by making certain we are using the proper material that will not be absorbed by fire, and not material that will become combustible by fire like wood, hay, or straw that will be easily consumed when they come in contact with fire. Therefore, as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ, we must be careful in the material we use to build our lives for the glory of God. We must make certain the material we use is non-combustible material. That's why I believe we can't. The Bible teaches us that God did not give us a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and a sound mind. We need to be mindful of that. We need to root ourselves in the word of God that we might know what God is saying to us and saying to us that we might be able to live in a line according to his will and his way through his word. However, take note of the fact that we have two options according to our text: gold, silver, precious stone, which are non-combustible materials. Wood, hay, and straw are combustible materials. There is a big distinction between the two categories. Now remember, Paul is talking about our maturity in Christ. Therefore, when I think in reference of what we as an OWBC family are all about and what we have achieved in our 25-year existence for the glory of our God, I, as your pastor, we must carefully be intentional in our selection process of how we are building our lives for the Lord. However, we have achieved as a church is no small accomplishment, brothers and sisters, at least from my perspective. when I think about all that has unfolded these past 25 years and what as we as collectively as a church have achieved, and make no mistakes about it, I have been here from our inception. Come on, say amen.
Amen.
And yet, although we have lost many key individuals along the way who were very vital in our success, understand as a body of believers, many of you have been instrumental to persevere and endure to assist in completing a mortgage to its completion. And many upgrades throughout our building, we have had purchased needful items to enhance the gospel message of our God. Therefore, not only do we celebrate our achievement, but I truly believe the Lord is pleased with what we have done in our 25-year history of service for his glory. Come on, let the church say amen. However, brothers and sisters, I am personally thankful for our finance ministry and her leader for their sacrifice weekly and over the years to make certain our finances were placed in the proper entity that we might get the best bang for our buck. For we here at OWBC, we don't believe in placing all of our eggs in one basket. But I am also grateful to our finance team in their service and due diligence over the years. And it has been my prayer that the Lord will add their work to their spiritual account for the faithfulness of service of which they have rendered. And all the people said,
amen.
Come on, y'all, say amen. Y'all got to get with me this morning. I'm on fire. Y'all all quiet and act like, you know, y'all scared to say amen. Say amen if you can. For the scripture teaches, for by thy faith, be thy faithful unto death and death until, be thy faithful unto death, not unto death, brothers and sisters, until, that means, amen, until you die, amen, not unto, because unto means you can stop doing what you're doing and then do something else, but God said, be thy faithful unto death, amen. Therefore, I applaud each of the ministry team members of our finance team for your sacrifice service. Now to jump right into our lesson for this morning, brothers, says, according to this chapter, the Apostle Paul also warned these Corinthian believers to not be deterred by all the negative obstacles that could stunt their spiritual development. And neither should we, OWBC. That's why I said what I said. We ain't shutting down no more. Amen. I'll be here preaching to these chairs, but we ain't shutting down no more. For God did not give us a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and a sound mind. In fact, Paul wanted this church to understand that they were a living body, and their goal, both corporately and individually, should be to mature in Christ, regardless of what they had to encounter or endure. Paul wanted this church to move from the milk of God's word to a deeper level of living in Christ. Paul's goal in our text was to see these believers move into the bread, the meat, and the honey of God's word, that they might grow to maturity in Christ. Now understand, brothers and sisters, milk truly does the body good, and milk is necessary to keep the body strong and to grow strong muscles. However, Paul is not speaking about our physical bodies, but growing us up spiritually. You see, brothers and sisters, a baby that is on milk has a digestive tract like a loud voice on one hand and no responsibility on the other. Then Paul compared the saints of God at Corinth to a field, the goal of which is productivity. Not only was this field to be productive, but this field could demonstrate the quality and quantity of life to which God is calling each of us to live. The Apostle Paul is addressing the believers at Corinth, but he is also addressing believers like us today in this 21st century. Now understand, every believer in Christ should be living to demonstrate the fruit of the Spirit in our lives. According to Galatians 5:22-23, for the book of Galatians teaches us to demonstrate love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, and self-control. Now, in order to achieve the fruit of the Spirit, understand, take note of the fact that it says fruit. singular and not fruits with an S, because all these characteristics represent one tree and can only be obtained by our maturity in Christ. Therefore, understand the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity, will assist us and work with us in order that we can, that the saints of God can be productive. But we also must have unity among the body of Christ. Now, if as a OWBC family, we have been able to celebrate a mortgage burning ceremony, and we celebrated it in the retirement of our mortgage during my tenure as your pastor. Now, I'm not bragging, but we are blessed to not have a monthly payment, but we still need your faithful giving to the work of the Lord. Amen. You know, I don't talk about money a whole lot, but y'all got to bring y'all monies to the storehouse, because I need to get paid. Amen. But we are still in need of your faithful giving to the work of the Lord, especially in this season. However, as your pastor, I don't ask you to give more, no more than what the Lord expects, and the Lord honors, and he honors tithe and offerings. Yes, and prayerfully, our membership is listening to me. Amen. And you, amen, you can mail your offerings in. We'll make sure they get where they need to go. Better yet, the Bible said, bring your tithe and offerings to the storehouse. But if you can't bring it, at least mail them in. Now understand, we have completed our mortgage and any sooner than we did, and we are appreciative to the Lord for his favor toward us and allowing us to do so, especially during these trying times. However, when I think about the critical times we are living in, I thank the Lord that we were able to complete our mortgage by paying off when we did. And every person that participated in our campaign initiative, Beyond the Walls, Why the Walls, and the Other Side of the Walls. Especially when we think about what has unfolded in our world these past months. The year 2020, we had high hopes of achieving even greater things to the glory of our God, but during this 2020 calendar year, and it is what's supposed to be a year of new vision and promise, but not so, brothers and sisters. However, brothers and sisters, unbeknownst to us that our country would be plagued with a pandemic that seemingly has set us, a lot of us, back, which has caused all kind of difficulties in our world. Therefore, what a blessing and a relief it has been for OWBC to know we don't have to be concerned with and about a monthly mortgage payment hanging over our heads. Especially since this past month, we have been back in session as a church dealing with this pandemic, and our finances and attendance alone has suffered as a result, just like many other churches, brothers and sisters, across the country. Givings and attendance has been extremely down. Therefore, make no mistakes about it, in spite of what's going on in our world, we are truly grateful for our achievements as a body of believers in Christ. And I would be remiss if I didn't pause and celebrate our finance ministry. Come on, give them a hand. Amen. Our ministry leader and their staff. Amen. Lord just called one of our finance ministry leaders home a few days ago, but in their due diligence in assisting us to achieve such a milestone in our short history. Therefore, as we remember the days gone by, we can also rejoice in the present as we rebuild our future. And I just believe that alone is a campaign initiative. Amen. Remembering the past and rebuilding the future. Therefore, understand, we can't afford to become complacent, church. And above all, brothers and sisters, we can't become stagnated. For time is running out as fast as the wheel of time is moving. I know you heard that, and folk are dying that have never died before. But you see, productivity is to understand to whom much is given, much is expected, and much is required. We understand all that we have achieved thus far in our history didn't come easy. Things didn't come easy, but it has taken hard work, commitment, and focus from the entire body of Christ in order for us to achieve what we have accomplished as a body of believers to the glory of our God. But understand, this was a goal that took productivity of every member. And we have had the presence and the unity of the body to have achieved such a goal in a short period of time. And yet understand, unity starts from within, church. To be unified is not uniformity. And understand, they are not the same. They are not synonymous. Uniformity is not the same as being unified. I just thought I'd throw that in free. It don't cost you nothing. However, let's check out what our text is teaching us. Take a note. Take a look at what verse 8 says. It teaches us as the Apostle Paul addresses this church. Paul writes, "Now he who plants and he who waters are one, and each one will receive his own reward according to his own labor." Now, Paul explained that he and Apollos were in the same business. They wasn't jogging over position. They were not fighting over who was going to be in charge and who should call the shots. Although the text teaches us one watered and the other planted, but it is God and God alone who gives the increase. Listen, brothers and sisters, harmony, unity, and togetherness and one accordance should always be the goal among the people of God. You see, a church working together for the cause of Christ is about unity. Understand that unity is always the goal. The scripture teaches, how can we walk together except we agree? Listen, if everybody play their part and stay in their lane with the understanding that there is only one star in this show, and if your name is not Jesus, then you need to find your place and get in it. Now, this was one of the key reasons the early church in the book of Acts was so effective and productive. You see, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, not just on the day of Pentecost, but the Bible teaches they continued with one mind, singleness of heart, praising God, and the Lord added to the church daily such as that should be saved. And if we're seeking to rebuild our congregation, and as we rebuild the Lord's house, now what God has started, he will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. But we must be on one accord and have the singleness of heart as we strive for the cause of Christ. For this pandemic got people who were regular attendees in the body of Christ running scared. Don't get me wrong, brothers and sisters. I ain't mad at them. That's why I ain't forcing the issues of coming to church, because I know we scared to death. But you got to be mindful. We got to walk in the scripture. We got to walk in light of what the Bible teaches us. Why is it necessary to huddle up here on Sundays and don't walk in what the Bible teaches us? God did not give us a spirit of fear. God is able, well, capable, and able to protect us from seen and unseen danger. Amen. Remember, Jesus said in the Gospel of Luke, in the last days, there will be a great falling away. Amen. So therefore, as the people of God, just like we are in the winter season, we are just might be in the winter season as it relates to the return of Christ. Perhaps the season we are in just may be the Lord need to weed out the real saints from the sinners. Maybe this is the season behind the pandemic that has gotten folks so afraid to even come to church, to the house of prayer, to worship God. However, if we follow the plans for which we already have in place, we can worship in safety. However, you know how people are. People want to come in God's house and create their own rules. Listen, we are already adhering to the CDC guidelines, but now we have to deal with your guidelines too. I think not. Now, if we are going to build on the proper foundation as we seek to rebuild our congregation based on no fault of our own, brothers and sisters, we must rebuild with the goal of quality material. Paul described this relationship conducive to spiritual productivity. According to verse 9, listen to what Paul says, "For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field. You are God's building. Therefore, as fellow workers in Christ, we are to live and work in harmony. But everything we do is to be motivated by and under the possessive supervision of God and God alone. We are his fellow workers. Therefore, God not only knew about Paul, not only knew about spiritual requisitions for the growth of the individual Christian, but he also knew about the mechanics of building a church. Understand, Paul was a master strategist. Now, here's what I mean by master strategist. As soon as Paul would enter a community for the first time, Paul would head straight to the local synagogue and start his preaching ministry with the reading from the law. When enough of the local Jews had come to accept Christ, Paul would then go with that small band of converts and begin to preach to the Gentiles outside of the synagogue. Simply because Paul was the foundational leader of the church, which he would subsequently build in that particular community, it would include both Jews and Gentiles. Paul knew the foundation of any structure predetermines the quality of the structure. The foundation would determine how high a building can be. It determined the length, the width, the dimensions of that building, but also the function and its purpose. All of those things are dependent upon the foundation of any building, brothers and sisters. Now watch this. According to verse 10, hopefully you ain't close your Bibles, because that's why we miss so much, because we close our Bibles too soon. Paul says, according to verse 10, according to the grace of God, which was given to me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation and another built on it, but let each one take heed how he built on it. Now, the Greek word for master builder is also the word which we derive our English word architect. However, this is not just a draftsman who draws up some plan. No, brothers. This individual is one who lives and works with a structure from conception to completion. The master builder or architect draw the plans, but even before this takes place, this is the concept. This is a concept and a dream. This person has a clear understanding what the building will be used for, and that understanding is based from which he designed and plans the entire structure. Now, because this person has invested a considerable amount of time and interest in the structure from the drawing board, when the actual structure begins, this person will be directly involved in the entire process. Now, understand, Paul was constantly utilizing his spiritual and human gifts to promote the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Therefore, here's food for thought, brothers and sisters. Those who think they are too good or too busy to knock on doors or get involved with the physical aspect of the church because they are too busy teaching the Bible or too busy involving themselves in the day-to-day tasks of the work of the Lord, these individuals need to first understand they must first practice what they teach and preach before they have any right to share those teachings to anyone. Come on, say amen. Y'all surely is quiet. Listen, brothers, it's a whole lot for me to tell you what you ought to do, but in the same respect, I should be willing to practice those very same principles. If we are truly building on the foundation of Jesus Christ, it was Jesus who said, I came not to be served, but to serve. We all need to practice what we teach and preach. None of us should be that important that we can't be involved in the practical aspect of the church. The scripture says, whatsoever you find your hands to do, do it with all of your might. No one can do all the work. However, if we all pitch in, there's enough work for all of us to do, because the harvest truly is plenteous, but the labors are few. Therefore, according to what Paul in this text established his own credibility as a foundational man, a master builder. Yet Paul moves on to the foundation itself. Now, Paul had already stated that foundation was based on chapter 1, verse 2. He determined to know nothing but except Jesus and him crucified. Jesus was the whole and the only foundation of all the churches Paul started on his missionary journey. Therefore, as a New Testament church, even today and in Paul's day, the gospel tells the story of the life, the death, and the resurrection of our Lord. The book of Acts begins the story of Jesus' ascension and continues with the coming of the Holy Spirit. the overall activities within the early church, the epistles commenting on how we ought to implement the teachings of Jesus that we enunciate during our earthly ministry. The book of Revelation reaffirms that Jesus will indeed come again and rule the earth. Now, one of the very simple reasons I believe, and this is my own personal conviction based on my own personal observation, why churches are ineffective and they're struggling in the 21st century. First of all, 21st century churches today, we have too many chiefs and not enough Indians. In other words, everybody want to be in charge. We want to tell people what to do, but we don't want to get our hands dirty for the glory of God. It's all due to my personal opinion to the fact that churches have built their foundation on the humanness of Jesus and yet have rejected the supernatural aspect of the person and his ministry. Now, the problem with this premise is that we can't humanly comprehend that Jesus can't possibly be adequate to meet all of our human needs. Well, as we press on through this text, look at verse 11. Paul explained that there is not even a remote possibility of laying a genuine foundation without Jesus Christ. Now, understand, Jesus was 100% man and he was 100% God. Jesus was the great God man. He became man so he could identify with us and the pressures of life that you and I encounter, brothers and sisters. Jesus, through his humanity, knew what it meant to deal with the ups, the downs, the trials, the tribulations, and the troubles and temptations of this life that you and I deal with. Jesus was a man, but he was also God. He was omniscient, all-knowing. He was omnipotent, and yet he had all power in his hands. And yes, Jesus is also our advocate and our intercession. We have our great high priest, brothers and sisters. In fact, John expressed it this way: Jesus is a propitiation for our sins, and not for our sins only, but also for those of the whole world. But then the Hebrew writer joined the chorus and wrote, "For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was at all point tempted as we are, yet without sin." Jesus, the great God man, knows what you and I are going through and what we're dealing with. Amen. This pandemic may have caught you by surprise, but it never caught God by surprise. Well, what Paul established is the necessity of the foundation, but then he deals with the nature of the foundation. Paul goes on to talk about the material that we should use to erect the building. According to verse 12 and verse 13, it says, "Now, if any man build upon the foundation with gold, silver, precious stone, wood, hay, straw, each man's work will become evident, for the day will show it according, because it will be revealed with fire, and that fire itself will test the qualities of each man's work." Paul here lists the materials that are available on the construction of the building: gold, silver, precious stone, wood, hay, and straw. The durability of the building will be determined by the choice of materials, brothers and sisters. Now understand, gold, silver, precious stone have lasting value. When tested by fire, all these materials will get under fire. It's just a good cleaning. However, wood, hay, and straw, these materials may be easy to get, but when tested by fire, they are also easily consumed and destroyed. Therefore, my question to each of us this morning is this: what kind of material have you chosen to build your life that God has planted within you? Now, I realize, brothers and sisters, this is our morning worship and not a special celebration service. However, I'm not talking about your physical material it takes to structure a building. You see, most Christians will settle for cheap and temporary material like wood, hay, and straw simply because they don't have the discipline or discernment to hold out for the very best. And yet most marriages, homes, and churches and even our lives are in trouble today, all because of the material that we have been using to construct and equip the foundation. There is no stability because of the foundation. None of the materials can't withstand the crisis. This is one of the very reasons we have a great falling away from the church attendance. Listen, we want durable material. It's not an issue. Being willing to pay for it and to go after them is a whole different matter. It costs, we told you last week, it costs us to be the Lord's disciple. And it will cost something to make certain that the church is centered on Jesus Christ. It can be expensive to forego some of the things the world should say accompany corporate success. It is sometimes far more difficult to love, work, and cry through family problems than it is to blame another person and ignore one's own responsibility in the matter. Without the supernatural enabling of the Holy Spirit, most of us would never be able to survive such experiences. However, we must remember the book of Psalms teaches us in 127 verse 1, except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. You see, you can have a house and not have a home because it's not built on the foundation of Jesus Christ. Or we can have a church and it not be built on Christ, the chief cornerstone. When the winds of life begin to blow upon it, it will not be destroyed. However, I'm mindful of what Jesus said. He said, upon this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. But then finally, brothers and sisters, let's just bring this plane in for a landing. We can rest in the promise of God's word. Listen, if we keep the word, we shall be kept by the word. Let me just say that again for somebody that didn't hear me. I say, if we keep the word, we shall be kept by the word. Listen, it is vitally important that there be a protective power in our hearts to guard us in times of temptation so that we shall not be tempted above that we are able to bear it. A church is based on none other than the Lord Jesus Christ and the principles of his word will withstand any test the world can offer, even this current pandemic. Yes, and yes, brothers, I'm about to land this plane, but before I do, I got a few more principles to share. So therefore, before I land this plane, take a look at verse 13 through 15. What we have is the promise that describes the day that will come when the structure has been chosen, the structure we have chosen to build, the material we have used to build will be examined by the Lord himself. In fact, Jesus will look at our building with his fiery eyes and determine what kind of material we have used. The scripture says, if this earthly tabernacle be destroyed, we have another building not made by the hands, but eternally in the heavenlies. In fact, according to 2 Corinthians 5:10, Paul calls this day, he calls this day the judgment seat of Christ. This is the time when the works of all believers will be revealed and tested in the fire of God's presence. So let's just land this plane by taking a closer look at verse 13 and 15. It says, each one's work will become clear, for the day will declare it because it will be revealed by fire. And the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. If anyone's work which he has built on it endures, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet so as through fire. Now understand, the fire of the Lord Jesus' judgment when he returned will not only be a revealing fire, it will be a refining fire and a purifying fire. Now the Greek verb for declare or reveal means to show it in its true character or to reveal it for what it is. In other words, the Lord Jesus Christ will look at things from the inside out to look at it from its core. Jesus will not only want to know if you live for him or build for him, he's going to check out our motives, brothers and sisters. Now, if a believer's work is found to be worthy of the foundation, then it will not only survive, but it will be purified by fire. If it withstands the fire, the fellow worker be rewarded with wages for which he have not earned. However, if a man's work is burned up, then that person will receive no reward. Now, although this person's salvation will remain intact, brothers and sisters, in other words, once saved, always saved, if so, still holds true, even at the judgment seat of Christ. However, the distinction Paul is making here is not between the saved and the other say, but between those who have built wisely and those who have built foolishly. Now understand the imagery, brothers and sisters. What Paul is representing is a structure which can either withstand fire or because it is built with non-combustible material. In other words, this structure was built because the material that was used was gold, silver, and precious stone. Again, these are non-combustible materials or structure that will be consumed by the same fire, all because it was built with combustible material, wood, hay, and straw. This is because of God's grace, even the foolish builder will make it to heaven, brothers and sisters. But there will be the pain one must endure. It's all due to how much more could have been accomplished for the Lord's purpose if the right material had been used. Well, Paul's emphatic words in the Corinthians to the Corinthians was not about their physical structure, but about their relationship to Christ. It's about our service to and for the Lord. Now understand what, while Paul lovingly identified with these fellow believers by addressing and calling them brethren, he sternly was admonishing them to grow up. And a lot of us need to grow up. Quit being so scared. I believe that the word of, that's a word for somebody today. We got to grow up in the fear and admonition of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Also, Paul points out that their spiritual diet was a clear indication of their immaturity. Then Paul used two other analogies to show the Corinthian believers their option. As a God's field, they were preoccupying themselves with the petty concerns of who would water and who would plant, or they could appropriate God's priorities and be concerned with the productivity of the field that symbolized each person's life. You see, as God's building, each individual Christian can choose to build a house or a home. Therefore, my question to us this morning is this: are you building on the proper foundation? Are you building your lives for the Lord Jesus Christ? Are you giving God the best of your service? Or to put it another way, are you moving from the milk of God's word to the meat of God's word? You may think it don't matter, but it will, brothers and sisters, in the sweet by and by. Upon the Lord's return at the judgment seat of Christ, for which we all will appear. In fact, the best way I can explain it is through the words of a songwriter. This is the songwriter put it like this. Amen. You may build great cathedrals, large or small. You may build skyscrapers grand and tall. You may conquer all the failures of your path, but only what you do for Christ will last. But then he continues by saying, you may seek earthly powers and fame. The world might be impressed by your great name, but soon the glories of this life will all be past, but only what you do for Christ will last. Though your armies may control your each hemisphere and your orbits out in space cause men to cheer, your scientific knowledge may be vast, but only what you do for Christ will last. Though your songs and prayers are heard by and praised by men, but they have no meaning unless you've been born again. Sinner, heed these words. Don't let this. Excuse me. Don't let this harvest pass, but only what you do for Christ will last. Listen, I speak for you, but my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and his righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other grounds are sinking sand. Listen, those of you that have never made the transition, in times like these, you need a savior. In times like these, you need an anchor. And you got to be sure and be very sure your anchor holds and grips the solid rock, because this rock is Jesus. I shared with you last week, brothers and sisters, the significance and the sufficiency that we need that is found in Christ. And it's spelled out in his very name. J, he justifies us. E, he edifies us. S, he sanctifies us. U, he unifies us. And I don't know about you, but I'm satisfied with that last S. You see, they hung him high and they stretched him wide. He bowed his head, brothers and sisters, and then he died. Amen. And one day, brothers and sisters, soon and very soon, we might well get ready. Amen. We are in the season that God's going to break the clouds and he's going to come back and snatch us up out of here. The Bible said, the dead in Christ shall rise first, and those that remain shall be caught up to meet our God in the air. And brothers and sisters, I don't know about you, but I'm looking forward to that great caught up, that great getting up morning where we will be able to be with Jesus throughout eternity, where the Bible says there will be weeping, where we will, where brothers and sisters, there will be no more crying, there will be no more dying, amen, there will be joy, amen, as we share the presence of our Lord, because he said, I go away to prepare a place for you, and where I am, there we shall be also. We're looking forward to the day to going back to be with our Lord Jesus Christ, brothers and sisters. So make no mistakes about it. Don't let this pandemic stop you from being what you need to be for the glory of our God. Make sure you are building on your life with combustible material like brother and sister text told us. Amen. We need to make sure that we're using non-perishable materials. Amen. Not perishable materials. We need to make sure that we are building our lives on what the Lord Jesus Christ. So my question to you this morning, are you building on the proper foundation, and are you using the proper materials? Amen. And so we extend the privilege of the church by inviting somebody that may not know our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ to come to know him in the pardons of their sin. And if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that Christ was raised from the dead, the Bible says, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart, man believeth unto righteousness, but with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. Jesus said himself, amen, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. Amen. Remember this, Jesus said himself, amen, that the harvest is truly plentiful, but the laborers are few. And brothers and sisters, we need to get right today because time is truly running out. We need to make sure our lives are right with Christ. Amen. And not just talk a good talk, but walk a good walk. Amen. By inviting the Lord Jesus Christ into your heart. If you want special prayer, amen, we'll pray with you. We'll pray for you. I know this pandemic has been tough for all of us, brothers and sisters. So we'll lift you up through prayer. Amen. If you don't know Jesus in the pardon of your sin, you can invite him into your heart on this morning by confessing, believing, and receiving. But then also, if you are saved and you are connected to the work of the Lord through the church, amen, you are connected to the body of Christ, because Jesus is coming back for the church that's without a spot or blemish. Are you using the proper materials to